What I have in common with the three authors that I constantly refer to, with Friedrich Nietzsche, with Georges Bataille, and the Zimbabwean writer, Dambudzo Marechera, is a very odd paradox of thought, but I believe that this strange psychological construct, for that is what it is, comes from a very formalistic training in Christianity. And I believe that if you haven't had that profound level of Christian discipline and ideology imposed on you, you're probably not going to get the mood of where they seem to be coming from, these writers. And so consequently, it could be a little difficult to explain, but of course I will try, because I must. Let me dive in at the deep end. When I was growing up, I had to comply with very formal patterns of behavior and thought, which were largely influenced, if not totally dominated, by the Christian paradigm. For instance, the doctrine about the family, and about the father leading the family, and about authority, and about deference to one's parents, and about always telling the truth, and about having a polite but constrained relationship to others that wasn't on over-familiar terms. So this was the very disciplined training I had growing up. And of course, we'll try to remember that Nietzsche's father was a Lutheran pastor. He must have had a similar training. Bataille, his father was an atheist, but very aggressive, possibly narcissistic. And Bataille turned to the Catholic Church in rebellion against his father, so probably got the same very, very disciplined, a very strict training. Marechera could not avoid, as a colonial subject, being disciplined, as it were, by the Anglican system. He went through an Anglican school and got his academic training there. And of course, Christianity was all around. So there is this background in common. And as I say, I want to swoop in at the deep end, if I can. And I'll say that my mood growing up was like this. It was like the constraint was my parents' implicit command to me. Don't tell us what you think. Don't tell us what you feel. Because if you tell us the truth, we will surely not be able to face ourselves. And we will surely hate ourselves, and we will not be able to cope. So just stick to these very formal principles, these formal ideas, and this formal arrangement, and don't express any organic observation or spontaneous observation, because that will hurt us to the quick, and we can't cope with any observation of that sort. We can't cope with any spontaneity of any sort. That's deeply hurtful to us. It's that's going to rock us and maybe overturn us, and we will probably not survive your communication. So, like I say, I believe that these other three authors had a similar upbringing to some extent. And I believe that that would have had a huge impact on their sense of what communication was. Communication was not blurting forth something naturally or spontaneously, and certainly it was not an attempt to manipulate or dominate people. by the power of your wonderful language or your great capacity for influence. Far from that, I believe that for these writers, communication had this quality of shamefulness and the sense that one had to transgress one's own internal control mechanisms in order to communicate at all. As we see in Nietzsche's writing on Zarathustra, there is that strange phrase, speak the truth and break Zarathustra. Speaking the truth is to break. You break something, maybe you break yourself, but the fear is that one might break other people. And so there's a deep sense of having to feel shame and to overcome shame through the process of communication. And always that sense, in me at least, that by communicating, I risk hurting people very badly just by the act of normal communication, and that they will not be able to cope. And generally, I think I've been proven right. I have often had that sense that people cannot cope with it, not very well. But the reaction that has confused me the most is when people say, well, you were only communicating so as to control or manipulate other people, which would mean that I had the kind of facility with communication and the kind of agenda to do with it, something that is not actually a part of my nature. I would have to be much more modern and much more casual and much more lacking in circumspection and concern and awareness of my environment if I were to suddenly launch in and communicate without any thought except to dominate others. That actually makes no sense to me. I think when you have to, if you want to get what's deep out of Marechera, if you have to get what's deep, if you want to get what's deep out of Nietzsche or out of Bataille, you've got to see that their communication is a risk. They feel that they're taking a risk by communicating what they do, and that is, in its own way, heroic and noble to communicate with you at all, because it's easier not to. And that's my deep sense of things, and it is, of course, it's that sense of the sacred in communication and that sense of transgression in communication is not an easy thing to communicate with people who haven't had that very strict, very suppressive, harsh, rigid upbringing, because they don't really know why the communication should be any kind of a risk, or why you should have difficulty with it, or why you should feel ashamed, or feel, I shouldn't have said anything, I hurt everybody by mentioning anything about reality from my perspective. Do I dare disturb the universe? It's an old-fashioned sensibility for sure. But I think, you'll not be able to get that sense of the sacred out of a text unless you actually have that sensibility, at least a little bit, at least to some degree.